Do you have before you the September 6th letter from Ivan?
Yes.
Summarizing the infrastructure committee, basically the reason this committee was formed is in the planning process, dealing with ongoing development here in the town, an ongoing problem with that is dealing with improvements to the infrastructure off-site from residential and commercial development, and how we deal with that as planners. And we felt it was prudent of us as a planning board to work on planning in the next decade, in the 90s, as to take a look at the town infrastructural system and summarize what we foresaw as potential problems, more immediate problems, intermediate problems, and more far-reaching problems, and just to explore some of the ways that the planning board and the town might deal with having the developer share at least a proportionate part of the burden of some of those improvements and the needs required. And basically, the letter describes pretty well. We sat down over a number of times, identified not as engineers or experts in infrastructural study, but just as town citizens, where we saw infrastructural need, where we, and then applied it to where we foresaw potential growth in the town. There are numerous ways of assessing the contribution of the infrastructural need to the developer. The process that we're trying to at least get started here is to formulate at least a method that the planning board can deal with off-site infrastructural needs. I guess primarily to answer any questions you might have, looking at recommendations A, B, and C, I might say in section C that the town should investigate the feasibility of using impact studies, impact fees, and other types of mechanisms to have a proportionate share of the cost of these new infrastructure improvements borne by the new development. We did not necessarily investigate all of those different types of mechanisms, in that we were trying to bring those forward as lots of different possibilities.
I particularly like the way you prioritize the the infrastructure needs as immediate, near future need and long range need.
Really did just took long lists of areas and locations and where the need really arose in those. And I wouldn't say that those that we picked, the three that we picked, were arbitrary, but they certainly were drawn from those where we saw the most activity or the predominance of need.
Hasn't there been some technical analysis of some of these areas already?
Pardon, I didn't understand your question.
I believe that there are some technical analyses that have already been done on certain of these areas. Is that right?
I see Mike nodding his head. I guess you're talking about traffic studies.
Traffic studies.
I think the problem the planning board deals with is how to implement these, and whether it's need, commercial need, or housing needs, housing proposals before the planning board, which is going to add pedestrian traffic to the downtown area. While it's off-site, whether sidewalks there or crosswalks or traffic lights, there's no, to our knowledge, any procedure or process to develop a developer contribution to those improvements.
Thank you very much. Any questions from, yes, Councilor Glover?
Steve, I'm wondering if you can give a quick overview of both the advantages and disadvantages of using impact fees, if you have that kind of background information, so everybody's aware of this, that kind of system.
I really can't.
Okay.
Like I said, we didn't go into that. And on purpose, I mean, we felt that that we simply bring up all of the different, when we looked at, for instance, splitting the town into quadrants and identify the needs by quadrant and dispersing, you know, the contribution, is the development activity in that area so it contributes directly to there? Is it in a different area so that it shares, for instance, if it's in the southwest quadrant of the town where residential development is taking place, but there is need in the northeast quadrant, does a contribution, does a shift around the town, or is it directly to improvements or development close to the business district? Is that, you know, is it more directed to the immediate need or that the development's causing?
Thank you. Any other councilors? Mr. McGovern.
Yeah, what I would like to suggest, Bob Malley, the Director of Public Works, and I are going to be working in the coming months on a roadway planning update of roadway and drainage projects. And that while we work on that, we also bring Maureen O'Meara, the town planner, in on that process, and particularly looking at the issue of impact fees and how they might serve to contribute to the priorities that are going to be outlined in that plan. Obviously, I think your number one priority here is something that, concerning the intersection right out here, the Shore Road, Scott Dyer, Route 77, is something that already is addressed in that plan. The council has submitted a proposal to the Area Transportation Planning Agency for some possible assistance on that. And so some of these are underway. A lot of good ideas.
Yes. And I want to thank you and the Planning Board for taking the initiative to do this study. Really good planning.
Just a minute.
Councilor Jordan.
If I may, when you put this together and you set it up with, I take it with priorities, and well, there's one or two of them there. It's all right to pick them apart.
Sure.
Give me some ideas. I like to do those things. The curve on Fowler Road and the one on Eastman Road, to me, are pretty similar as far as sharpness and what have you. I know they're in different areas of the town.
Fowler and which?
Eastman Road.
Eastman. Mm-hmm.
So I wonder why they went right together, that's all. Number two, the blind intersection of Wells and Sawyer. Where's the blind part of it? Where do you get that? I thought that was open pretty much up. Huh?
I think that's coming from 77, where you come up over the hills. If you're going west on Sawyer, turning left onto Wells, when people come up over that,
right,
off the marsh.
The southerly approach.
The southerly approach?
Again, I said we're not road engineers, and more than one member in the subcommittee mentioned that we didn't go out and check the site distance, but there is a sense of coming up over from behind that knoll, approaching, I think Mr. Tinsman said that they had just recently studied that intersection, but it was an area that we brought up in the subcommittee.
Okay, you mentioned dead-end roads, which to me they should be a higher priority, in my opinion, like Trundy Road, Broad Cove, Farm Pond Road, or Pheasant Road. I don't see the dead-end Pheasant Road, that's all.
Okay.
If you gather what I mean. On Pheasant Road, I don't see the dead-end part of it. Speaking of dead-end roads there, and they have Pheasant Road right in there with it, and I don't ever felt Pheasant Road was a dead-end road.
Right, I think the Farm Pond Road was placed in there, in parentheses, and I agree with you. I don't know why Pheasant, my understanding is that's not a dead-end road. I've been all the way through.
Okay.
I think.
Well, we can sort of accept your report, and then as Michael and Bob Malley are working with us and the planner, they can review and reanalyze.
Okay. Thank you very much.
I move that we accept the report from the planning board.
Any further discussion? All in favor? 7-0. Item number 95, to consider a report on a request from the Animal Refuge League to contribute to the cost of shelter services and take any necessary action. I believe that Mr. McGovern was going to give us some background on this. Would you like to come to the microphone? Counselor Creelman, as Finance Committee Chairman, will give back.
Well, actually not. As a dog lover, I'll be happy to speak on this. The town manager and I have gone back and forth on several occasions. Once this particular issue was presented to us several months ago with respect to the Animal Refuge League. Unfortunately, we don't have a lot of alternatives. As a matter of fact, we don't have any other than utilizing the Animal Refuge League for the upcoming year. I would ask Chief Pickering, though, to come up to the podium for a moment, because I know the chief has looked at the possibility of housing a possible kennel-type structure in Cape Elizabeth. At least at the moment, this is not cost-wise feasible, but I would like to get whatever input may be possible in terms of the future, because we feel quite honestly that this assessment is grossly over-assessed with respect to the number of animals that we will actually be dealing with the Animal Refuge League. Chief Pickering, could you just comment, because you've had direct dealings with this institution?
Certainly. First, I couldn't agree more with your assessment of the assessment, I guess. Presently, we take about 25 dogs over to the ARL each year, have for the last 2 years, so that translates to about $180 per animal if this $4,500 assessment goes through. I also agree that we don't have a lot of alternatives, and I've studied that along with other police chiefs that are affected by this in the area. I have contacted the Director of Animal Welfare in the state, Clyde LeClaire, and asked him for a copy of the regulations that govern these particular facilities. He promised me that they're being rewritten at this time, and he would send them to me. He said that they're not terribly restrictive, and there really isn't any reason that a municipality could neither have their own or subcontract with somebody to do this. And in fact, the state subsidizes the housing of these stray animals at, I think, it's $6 per animal per day. So there are a little bit of offsetting revenues in that regard. In the meantime, I have spoken with Chris Bond, who has indicated an interest in working with us. He's also been approached by several other municipalities, said that, because his priority rests with the Cape as they do business here. And I just leave that open to the council. If they want to pursue that, I'd be more than happy to do that with them. I understand there's some zoning issues and other things we have to concern ourselves with before a final decision was made, but I do think that we should pursue alternatives with as much vigor as possible in this, as it's an unbudgeted expense. We're going to have to put money for the next year.
Well, in the sense that it is an unbudgeted expense, we would be able to make the payment in July of 91, so it at least would not affect the current fiscal appropriations.
Correct. I intend to include that in my canine budget, my 215 account. And
this would be for the calendar year, basically January 1st, 1991 through December 31st, 91.
As I understand it, the managers, I believe, has had a conversation with the director of the ARL, and they would be for the calendar year, so we'd actually be 6 months technically in arrears, I guess, that we would pay in July.
And we're mandated to have this service?
Mandated by law, yes.
Thank you very much.
Councilor Pearson.
Yes, while the chief is here, please. How many dogs or how many stray animals annually? Got those figures.
We take 25 over to the ARL. We probably have, my guess would be about 75 a year, several of which we either notify the owners, they're either picked up at the station, or we take the animals to the owner's home. But the ones that we can't immediately identify of the 75, about 25 are taken over. We know that about 75% are claimed by owners. Just about. Mm-hmm.
And those 75%, do they pay the cost?
Yes, they do. And would continue to do so even though we were being assessed this money, as I understand it.
Councilor Reed.
Yes, I spoke at length with Chris Bond, and for the record, it's the Cape Elizabeth, the Veterinary Center of Cape Elizabeth is my next door neighbor. They are very interested in discussing with the town further, Chief, than today. I have spoken briefly with the town manager. There are zoning problems that have to be addressed and considered here, but the Veterinary Center of Cape Elizabeth treats most of the animals that are not taken to the Animal Refuge League. Anyway, it would cut down on many expenses of transport of animal, et cetera, and they have a very good working relationship, and they have an existing facility that would need minor modifications according to preliminary discussions. So Chris Bond has asked me to bring to the council his expressed interest in working with the town on this matter, and depending on what the deadline is for making this decision, he would like to spend further time with the chief, and he had already expressed that to the chief. So we may have another alternative, if not immediate, certainly within the next year. Thank you.
You're looking at me?
No, I'm just was not wanting any of you to think I had forgotten about you down there. Thank you very much, Chief.
Thank you.
For your research. I guess we have little choice as far as this particular year is concerned.
Well, I'm just, if I could just have a slight clarification from Councilor Reed. Now, we have approximately 6 weeks until law mandates we have to have a facility in place. Was your sense from Mr. Bond that given the nature of things that have to be gone through to get appropriate changes with regard to his current kennel situation, is it at all feasible to consider putting a hold on this, tabling the motion till the December meeting, or are we basically stuck? And I could refer this to the town manager, you know, for the calendar year 1991. I'd love to hear an alternative that wouldn't cost us $180 per dog.
I think the town manager can give you the answers.
Mr. McGovern.
I'm just up stretching. It's been sitting there quite a while. When the Cape Veterinarian Clinic was approved, there was quite a bit of public debate and a number of conditions were placed on the approval. One of the major public issues that came up at that time was whether or not a kennel or a boarding type arrangement was going to be allowed. Through that process, it specifically came out, you know, that there may be, within the care of animals, you know, that there may be a minimal amount, but it would not be a kennel, a boarding, a, you know, a place where animals are regularly boarded. And for that reason, you know, they would need to go back to the planning board and probably to the zoning board in order to amend their site plan approval. For those of you that have watched that process know that, you know, that can be month after month after month. You know, I think we are facing a deadline. You know, the dogs have got to go somewhere. And, you know, my sense is that, you know, we really ought to look at this for a one-year period, fully reserving the right to go elsewhere. In addition to that, and I don't want to sound like I'm defending the Animal Refuge League because I think their actions are indefensible, but I would like to point out that they're not only looking at dogs but also cats and other issues with this, that, you know, they're, and it's not only the police that bring animals there. According to Carol Monroe, the director, there's also other people who bring animals. And, you know, I think to simply say it's 180 per dog that we bring over is not quite, you know, an accurate number, because under state statute, municipalities are required to provide this service not only for the animals that it brings, but also animals that are found to be, that are stray in the community. And that is, in fact, a state statute. And I think the Animal Refuge League is aware of it, and they're taking full advantage of it.
Councilor Pearson.
I was going to say a question for Senator McGovern. Did the Animal Refuge League present us with their statistics as far as total animals that came from Cape Elizabeth?
I don't have that number with me, but in a discussion with the director, Ms. Monroe, she did relate a number, and it was quite a bit above what the chief has indicated, approximately
three times.
The amount the chief has indicated. Yeah.
So
55 is what I had calculated, so those numbers fit.
If not, I'll take a motion.
Excuse me.
Counselor Reed.
May I just ask one more question?
Sure.
We have to be in compliance with the state mandate on 1231.
It's not a suddenly it's a new state mandate. What it is the one vendor we have that we utilize that we can take these animals to has suddenly told us you don't have an arrangement by the end of this year that you start helping contribute, then we're shutting you off. And, you know, that's what the deadline is we're facing a shutdown. In fact, I read a deadline in the paper some time ago. They said they were going to do it August 1st. And I know a couple of counselors called me, what's this? And I called Mrs. Monroe, and she said, well, it's beginning January 1. As long as you have your issue resolved by then, along with the payment plan, she would be satisfied.
I would also, I was one of those counselors who called you about that. But I would like to know what possible harm it would do to table this until the December meeting, pending just some preliminary discussion on how much work needs to be done with the Planning and Zoning Board. The only reason I bring that up is that I am now replacing one of those neighbors who objected to the establishment of the veterinarian center, and I am not in opposition to it. And I didn't know how long a process that really was.
I think the owners of the Cape Veterinarian Clinic, if they want to expand their business, you know, that is up to them. And I feel a little uncomfortable with the municipality attempting to drive a process through the planning and zoning board. I know there's another proposal right now that's hanging around for the health fitness center, and a lot of that same thing is going on, that, you know, this ought to be looked at because the municipality itself or the government, municipal government, may have a special benefit from it. And I think, you know, you've got to look at the wider community issues, and there's a real danger of utilizing a conflict of interest that the municipality has to usurp or potentially usurp some more important land use decisions.
Well, just meeting the requirements for an application and having it filed in the proper time is not going to meet the deadline.
And, you know, we have no way of knowing what the bonds would actually come in for, and, you know, you can't presuppose what an application would consist. Okay. You get into trouble when you
Counselor
do that.
Counselor Amaro.
If we did postpone this and did not send in the amount as requested by the Animal Refuge League, could they refuse to accept animals from this community?
Right.
Well, with that, I would move that we contribute $4,500 as requested by the Animal Refuge League for use of their services for this calendar year.
Second.
Next calendar year.
Next calendar.
Counselor McLaughlin.
I have a question, Mr. McGovern. Don't go away from the microphone. Is it possible to have a six-month agreement with the Animal Rescue League as opposed to a one-year agreement?
I think if the council would like to, propose that, I'd go back and tell Mrs. Monroe this is what we've agreed to, and we'll let you know again in June. What our position then is.
I would imagine they may not be too happy if we say we want a six-month agreement, but we're not going to pay you till 6 months is up. But I think that may be one alternative for us to consider. It's a six-month agreement and see if any other alternatives open up in that time frame.
Would you want to amend your motion to that?
I think it would be highly, highly unlikely. I mean, this is November. I don't see any problem. No, I'll keep my motion the way it is. If it fails, someone else can submit it.
Okay. Councilor Jordan.
Yes. What I would like to hope that I would like to see this, and I think I'll vote against the original motion, because I think it could be tabled until December, and then we could still act on it. And in the meantime, they could come up with possibly a 6 months agreement, and maybe there'll be some other ideas come down the road in the meantime.
We've known about this for how long, Mr. McGovern? It's right after the budget.
Right after the budget. I think we probably first got a letter in July, maybe. And we tried to ignore it for a while.
It was after the budget, right.
We were unsuccessful.
So we have had some time to start investigating, and I believe the chief has already done that. So I'll move the motion. All those in favor of the motion as proposed? All those opposed? motion fails.
Therefore, if I may, I'll make a motion that is tabled until the December meeting, and for the manager to look into other alternatives, possibly a 6-month agreement,
just
and report back in December.
That hasn't been seconded yet, if I can make
no.
a quick comment. Yeah, I think it's fairly clear what the council wants. So, you know, my preference would be you authorize me to go back and tell them that that's what you want, half the amount of money for half a year, and, you know, so we can resolve the deal, and if they don't accept it, then I would come back next month, but, you know, to try to avoid the council having to revisit it if they agree with, apparently, my sense of what the council wants to see.
That's much more productive. Would you care to change your motion to that effect?
That we agree upon a 6-month agreement with the Animal Refuge League.
Is there a second?
Second.
Mm-hmm. You want to put a sum of money on that?
For 25 cents per capita, which would accomplish the same thing as 50 cents for a whole year.
Was there a second?
Yes.
Yes.
All those in favor of the next motion? Okay. Opposed? 6-1 passes. We'll be back in December. We love to continue things here. Item number 97, to consider a request for I'm getting ahead of things here. I know this is dragging, gentlemen. I'm trying. Item number 96, to consider a report regarding the status of proposed drainage improvements on Waterhouse Road and take any necessary action. Is Mr. Malley, or are you going to give background on this for us, please?
Yeah, Bob Malley, our Director of Public Works, is here to outline what brought this project about in terms of citizens' input and the engineering process that has occurred to this point in the specific recommendation.
Good evening. I think you're all familiar with Waterhouse Road. It's been included in the roadway improvements 5-year plan that we've been working on in the past, and it's been recommended through some concerns of some of the property owners down there that we do something with street drainage. The road was constructed, I believe, back in 1956, and it really didn't have a proper subsurface drainage system installed in it. But at the present time, we have street drainage that is exiting onto private property, and in times of heavy rain, there is flooding that occurs in people's basements down there. So in working with the town engineer, and I believe you have some recommendations in front of you, we looked at a basic program of remedying those problems. And rather than just come through with 2 or 3 clear-cut alternatives what to do, I requested that they come up with 3 different alternatives on drainage remedies and 3 different alternatives on pavement rehabilitation after the project is done. And I can just probably quickly outline the 3 alternatives of each one just to kind of give you an idea of where we're heading. As far as remedying the drainage problem, we have drainage alternatives A, B, and C. A is probably a quick fix. Basically involves the installation of a single catch basin on the easterly side of Bradford Road, and the installation of curbing in various areas to convey street drainage. Again, it's kind of a quick fix. There's some installations of limited underdrain to pick up the subsurface water, but it really doesn't address the problem as a whole. Drainage alternative B involves the installation of 3 catch basins, and I do have this plan up on the board here. It's probably hard for you to see, but it involves the installation of a basin on the easterly side and the westerly side of Bradford Road, and also on the southerly side of Waterhouse Road. It involves the installation of bituminous curbing to convey drainage into these basins and to keep it from private property. It also involves the installation of under drains, and if you've gone down the road to see the problems down there, part of the problems are that you've got a lot of underground drainage that's either following the crushed stone of the sewer trench or just coming from the ledges, which is this area right back here. So as a consequence, you've got a lot of frost-susceptible soils down there, and you get a lot of heaving in the spring. So The idea of the under drains is to convey that groundwater into the drainage system itself and convey it to an outlet. Drainage Plan B involves the installation of 5 catch basins along with under drain and curbing, and it's much more extensive than B, and I think my recommendation is that B really accomplishes what we need to do down there, and that involves eliminating the drainage from going down Bradford Road and also catching the drainage on Waterhouse Road itself. So it's my recommendation that that alternative B be the one that we go with. As far as pavement rehabilitation, again, we looked at 3 different alternatives. Alternative 1, again, probably the least costly, involves basically after the system was put in to shim and overlay the road afterwards. I would be against something like that because you're going to have reflective cracking come through in the pavement, and if you've been down there, you can see that the pavement is in fair to poor condition at the present time. Alternative 2 involves the removal of all the existing pavement in this section right here. It's especially poor on the westerly side of Bradford Road, and it's fair in this section right here. And the idea of that would be to reshape the road and reshape the crown of the road to allow the water to get into these drainage facilities. Right now, if the basins were put in, the water physically may not get to them unless we did the overlay. And again, if you overlay a road that has a lot of cracks in it, those cracks are going to come right through. It also involves, again, the installation of curbing in various areas to maintain that water flow. And alternative 3 is the most costly, and that really is a full-depth reconstruction of the road. It involves the installation of all new sub-base gravel, I really don't think it's warranted. I think, we really don't know about the soils down there, but I think the biggest thing is to get that drainage out of that sub-base. And, where it was constructed in 1956, they probably didn't use the best standards, but the idea is to get rid of that subsurface drainage. So I'm recommending alternative B and alternative 2. They're, I guess, middle-of-the-road alternatives. And I think it addresses 2 things. I think B addresses the surface and the subsurface drainage problems, and 2 really gives us a good pavement once we're done. I'll entertain any questions if you have them, or any clarifications on any of the alternatives.
Councilor Reed.
I just have a quick question. I went down there this weekend. There are 3 house lots for sale on the land that will join Bradford. Ocean House?
That's off from Ocean House Road. That's not connected with the project at all.
Oh, okay. Yeah. Thank you.
That's a subdivision that the City of South Portland approved. Probably never should have done.
On the other side of Trout Brook. If there are no other questions of Mr. Malley, then I'd like to move this along. Before you leave, I want to compliment you and your department on the fall cleanup, however.
Thank you.
Usual excellent job. Yes.
I want to echo that. I think it's nice to have a long-term look at the situation, but not take the most costly alternatives, and I think you've done a good job evaluating them and have made some good analyses and presentations.
We are slightly over budget on this. We originally proposed, I think, about $40,000 to do the work, and that planning was done back in, I think it was early 1987. And since that time, that was basically just the installation of storm drain structures, and I think we need to go a little bit beyond that and take care of the pavement problems.
Thank you. Councilor Jordan.
So I take it, in listening to your presentation, that once you get some storm drains in there, it'll help out the road base and what have you.
Exactly.
That is really your thinking, because it'll be perforated material and so on and so forth.
That's right.
So I go with you.
Are you making a motion, sir?
Oh.
Motion.
Making motions. I will so move that we will authorize the manager and the Public Works Director to proceed with the water problems on Waterhouse Road and Bradford Road with the sum of, excuse me, find it here.
Do we want to like?
$80,000. Is that correct? Or should I use this figure in the back?
Not to exceed?
Not to exceed.
Not to exceed, sorry.
Is there a second?
Second.
Mr. McGovern?
Yes, some may wonder how we got from 71.5 to 80,000. The primary reason is that there, if you read through the letter carefully, there aren't any funds set aside for some of this, a little bit of the surveying work as well as for the land acquisition, of the acquisition of easements that may be necessary. And what I'd like to do is have, as a very early step in this, is to have the engineers identify those areas that we need to obtain and to make sure, you know, since we are trying to help the neighborhood down there, that they are in fact willing to provide the necessary easements, because if they're not, you know, I would think that the council, you know, might want to rethink this as a priority if the residents, you know, aren't cooperative in providing the necessary easements. But I don't envision any problem there, but I wouldn't want to pay, you know, $6,000 for design and then find out that we're not going to get the easements we need.
So you'll get the easements up front?
As soon as they can fairly closely lay out the easements we need. You can see they've already done some work.
I would like to clarify that we do at the present time have a 5-foot drainage easement at the end of Bradford Road. So we really need to expand that, say, to 20 feet. So it's not like we're going in, you know, without an easement.
We also have some temporary construction easements as well. There'll be some legal cost in this that we've got planned for.
Councilor Amaro.
At what point should we make a presentation to the affected people?
Well, I think we should have a public, like a neighborhood type meeting, which we did on Sawyer Road. It proved very helpful and acquaints all the citizens with the project and how it's going to impact the street. And it seems to work very well.
Perhaps we should do that in December then? Do you think that would be?
That's not a council.
That doesn't have to be.
We don't do
we
that.
Don't have to do
no.
Okay, I'll move the motion. All those in favor of approving up to $80,000 for the Waterhouse Road drainage design correction? 7-0. Thank you, Mr.
Thank
Mayor.
You.
On to item number 97. To consider a request for tax abatement for the Greater Cleveland Realty Trust and take any necessary action. We have our town attorney, Mr. Tom Leahy, here. Would you like to give us background, please?
Thank you, Madam Chairman. Also here this evening is Attorney Peter Eisman, who represents the owner of this property. I think we can refer to it as the Inn by the Sea. The record owner is the Greater Cumberland Realty Trust. What you have is a request, a written request, on behalf of the taxpayer to abate the real estate taxes for two fiscal years, 1988 and 1989, and is presented to you as municipal officers. The tax assessor for Cape Elizabeth has granted a 1990 tax abatement. Under applicable Maine law, a taxpayer can seek an abatement from the municipal officers going back an additional 2 years, which would cover the 2 years in question. I'm not here tonight, and I don't believe you have to reach the factual merits of valuation, and that is because, in our opinion, the applicable state law indicates that your basis for abatement would only be based upon an error, illegality, or irregularity in assessment. I don't know all the world of sins that could include, but perhaps it would be, for example, an assessment of somebody else's property as yours, or twice as much property as you actually have, assessing property to the wrong party. There are various errors and irregularities that would be contemplated by that. In our opinion, the additional sentence to that provision indicates that the municipal offices may not abate taxes for an error in valuation. We think that's controlling here. We think the essence of the applicant's request to you is to abate taxes based upon an error of value. In general terms, I understand the error in value alleged, which again I have no opinion on, was to in error base it more upon replacement as opposed to an income approach to the value of the property. What I have done is prepared, I've given you my letter, opinion on this issue, prepared a draft order which is consistent with that opinion. Mr. Eisman is here this evening and may want to address this matter further on behalf of the applicant. So at this time, I'd answer any questions, and perhaps after if Mr. Eisman elects to speak to you, I'll be glad to answer any questions after that.
Are there any questions of the attorney at the moment? No, I guess not. Thank you, Mr. Leahy. Is there anyone else who would like to make a comment?
My name is Peter Reisman. This is a difficult statute to determine because it uses the language error in assessment, and then it uses the language error in valuation. And that's not language with which I'm familiar. Most people don't use that language. We use the term assessed value. That's what I know. I know what the assessed value of my house is. I think if I asked any of you what the assessed value of your houses are, you'd know. If I asked you what the assessment is, you'd give me the assessed value. If I asked you what the tax valuation is, you'd give me the assessed value. So I don't know about these two terms. There's no legislative history to help us, no case law to help us. Mr. Leahy has come up with a plausible explanation. Maybe right, I don't know. He says that assessment means a kind of taking of a picture of what you're going to assess, the who owns the land, how many square feet there are, etc. It's the elements that you're going to assess. Then you take it down here and you mix it all up, and that's the valuation. I'd say that our problem is in the assessment, because Mr. Daigle did not have the information he needed. And that information isn't just a mental process. It's physical information. He didn't have the records of the income stream. And so I think we fall within the statute. I think that the people who are familiar with the situation know that the current assessment for those 2 years was not done according to law, that it is an illegal assessment. Certainly for 1990, which was the only year, FY90, that Mr. Daigle had authority to rule, he said it was wrong, and he revised it. It's a situation where there are a lot of equities on the owner's side. If the assessment were proper for FY88 and FY89, then in all likelihood, this taxpayer would not owe you anything for past years. Or if he did, it would be a nominal amount. It's a serious matter to him, and it's an important matter. And I think it's well within the statute. And I hope you interpret the statute to reach this. Because what Mr. Leahy has suggested is a kind of statute of limitations, and a really severe one, only 1 year. And that's a forfeiture statute. And forfeiture statutes have to be very clear. And let's face it, this statute is not very clear. It doesn't just jump up and grab you with what it means. I hope you do consider it. I hope you grant it. I realize that if you do reach that point, there's sort of two levels of consideration here. One, do we reach it? And secondly, if we reach it, do we want to grant it? I realize that somebody's going to say, well, you know, this fellow should have paid his taxes on time. And yes and no. You got to realize, I hope you realize, that the same state authority that gives you the authority to tax your citizens also gives those citizens certain rights. And one of those rights is that they have 18 months to pay the taxes. town's protected during that time, the state made sure of that. But I don't think that anybody here wants to be a leader of a squad to squash taxpayer rights. I think we should respect the taxpayer rights, and we should realize that it's not as if he's got this money under the mattress and he's just gleefully keeping it away from the town. That's not the situation. We all know it's very rough times out there, very rough times in his business. I hope you look at the situation. I hope you do what you can.
Thank you, Mr. Reisman. Any other comments from anyone? Do you have a question of Mr. Reisman? Would you please come back to the podium? Thank you. Councilor McLaughlin.
Mr. Reisman, when did the inn start in business in Cape Elizabeth?
The fall of 1986.
And there were no, okay, I just want to understand some history here for my own benefit. Okay, so that was fiscal year 87.
No, I,
that's it.
Well, is that yeah. Right, Jerry? Is that FY 87?
The fall of 86?
Fall of 86.
Well,
the assessment.
Fiscal year 87. Don't confuse me with information okay. I don't need, please.
All right.
Okay, so fiscal year 88 was your first full year in business.
That's
then.
Correct.
Okay. And I'm hearing you say that there was the problems in the assessment, in your opinion, it's an illegal assessment. May I assume that, and I believe you also said you wanted stream of income assessment rather than valuation assessment.
Well, what happened around 1988 was that our state Supreme Court looked at the assessing statutes and said to the municipal assessors, you must consider income stream. Now, prior to that time, virtually no municipal assessors included income stream. So that at the time the assessment was done on this property, Mr. Daigle didn't ask for that information, and we didn't provide the information to him, because neither of us realized that it was relevant and important at that time. And then the law court comes along and it says, no, this is important. This is just as important as the number of square feet in a house, or the whether it's a 30,000 square foot lot or a 140,000 square foot lot. This is a key part of the assessment process for commercial properties. So it was after the fact that we learned that we were all treating the statute improperly.
That was fall of 89?
I'm not sure when that case came out. Do you remember the date of it?
It really wasn't the statute, though. It was a case.
No, it's the case I'm referring to.
It's about a year ago, the Red Bank case.
It was about a year ago then.
So
it was after all of this happened.
So it's after all of this. All right. If, as you say, and I certainly agree with you, it's not, the ordinance may be confusing. Who did you contact at the state level to get an interpretation of how they get their interpretation of the ordinance?
We didn't do that with anybody. What happened was we got the case from the law court that said this is what the statute means. And it was sometime after that that I went to see Mr. Daigle.
Are cases like that retroactive, as would be in this instance?
That wouldn't be the right term, but that would be the right effect. What the law court was saying is this is what the law is and always has been.
Okay. I'm surprised, I guess, that you didn't get some other information from at the state level if you felt that this was such an unclear statute.
The one that Mr. Leahy's given you an opinion on is not the one I'm referring to.
It's not. Okay.
They're two different statutes.
Okay.
The Red Bank case is a matter of how assessors go about establishing assessed values. This statute that Mr. Leahy has raised is the statute that authorizes municipal officials to issue abatements.
Mm-hmm. And you didn't get any interpretation from that,
well,
that statute at the state level, is what I'm hearing.
Neither Mr. Leahy nor I are aware of any secondary sources that go to the meaning of these words.
I may not be either, but I went and talked to somebody at the Bureau of Taxation and asked them what this meant. I guess I wish you had done the same thing.
Any other questions? And I guess I just want to maybe correct a misstatement that you just made. As far as the abatement, it does not authorize us as municipal officers to grant abatements in this particular type of a situation. So if we aren't authorized to do it, we're authorized that we can't. We're not authorized at all. Are there any other questions from councilors of either Mr. Leahy? You wish to make a...
I would like to hear from Mr. Leahy.
Yes, he's coming.
A couple points. The Red Bank case is South Portland Associates versus South Portland's 1988 case, and it's interpretive. It simply is what the law court has felt under those circumstances would be appropriate. If we had to go that far, I would say it would not be applicable, perhaps, because when this inn began, it did not have a stream of income that may have been a reliable basis to determine value from. The Red Bank apartments were converted after World War II and were there for several decades of income and expense information available. And under those circumstances, and the case was limited to those circumstances, the court said that the city should have looked at the income as a factor and perhaps a predominant factor for determining value. The assessor has to determine just value. Again, I think that, and the reason we prepared the draft motion the way we did, is that we feel that the language is clear and unambiguous. It states an abatement under this subsection to correct an error in the valuation of property may not be granted by the municipal officers. I can't imagine the legislature speaking more clearly on that issue. This isn't, as I said, assessing the wrong property, and I think clearly the request is for, in light of the 1990 abatement, now can we please look back at the 1988-1989 years and abate those, because there must be an error in valuation, and fairness and equity, please look back. I don't think it's particularly fair or unfair. I think what the legislature has said is they've been struck by errors in assessment and illegality and say, yes, let's open up a window to allow people to come forward, and if they have a case, let the municipal officers have the discretion to grant the abatement in certain cases of illegality or irregularity. But on value, if the person lets the time go by, I think the legislature could properly say that's a case where you don't have to give the person the extra 2 years, if you will, look back or an opportunity to come before the town or city. So we could debate, Mr. Reisman and I could debate at length interpretation. I feel, it's just my professional judgment as an attorney and as the attorney for the town in this instance, that the statute is clear and that I do not need to look at any cases, or in that case really isn't relevant. It may be relevant to what Mr. Daigle as an assessor should do as to any property today, but it doesn't relate to abatements over which you may not have any jurisdiction, quite frankly. I mean, they're two different issues, what I'm trying to say. So I guess, you know, this isn't a core, I'm not trying to rebut and go back and forth, but I thought those few points should be made. I don't feel that it's really an issue of a forfeiture. I think it was a balancing act that the legislature undertook and came up with this statutory framework that you have to work under.
Thank you. Any more questions? If not, I'll move this item. Councilor Pearson.
Madam Chairman and fellow councilors, I'd like to ask if I can be excused from this issue, just in case there's a perceived conflict of interest having to do with employment in the past with medicine.
Okay.
General consensus of the council? Thank you, Mr. Pearson. All right, let's, we have before us the proposed motion in regard to the request for tax abatement in reference to the Inn by the Sea. A finding of facts and conclusion of law for the final decision. We have a motion. Councilor Amaro.
Yes. I would move that the request for tax abatement for the Greater Cumberland Realty Trust be denied, and that we adopt the findings of fact and the conclusions of law as set forward in this memo before us this evening.
Second.
Any further comment? And in this finding of fact, it says that we do not, as municipal officers, have jurisdiction in this particular kind of abatement.
Does Mr. Reisman have a copy of that so we don't have to read it?
I'm sure.
Just hand it to me.
Well, I think it's fair for him to have a copy, so it wouldn't have to be all read.
You did not have a copy of this previously? Or did you leave it at home? He hadn't been forwarded one? All those in favor, the motion is made. It's 6-0. Yes, Mr. Leahy.
In case I don't stay till the hours of the morning, there are two then matters that you voted on tonight, the PORI and this one, both of which are in your capacity as municipal officers. I have I have orders and for you to sign on both of those for the record. So I'll leave those, if I can, with Deborah, so I can be certain tonight. And for the one on PORI, it must be attested so I can record it in the Cumberland County Registry of Deeds.
Item number 98, to consider acceptance of Dyer Pond Road related drainage rights in the stormwater weir and take any necessary action. Mr. McGovern, do you want us to vote on these acceptances for these three roads individually?
Yeah, it would be nice if we could talk about them all
as a group,
but okay. Vote on them individually so that when we check the record 20 years from now, when the chair checks the record 20 years from now, they can clearly see the different steps that were taken. I think it's with a certain measure of relief, perhaps on the part of the town and the developer, that this is on your agenda tonight. You know, I think particularly with the development field as it is today, it's quite an accomplishment for a developer to come in and to have actually completed some roads and to have completed them to the full satisfaction of the town engineer. I have letters on file in my office indicating that all of the improvements and requirements have been completed on Dyer Pond Road, Greystone Road, and Granite Ridge Road. In addition to the roads themselves, there are certain drainage rights which were originally agreed to be accepted by the town council back when these particular proposals, before they were given final approval by the planning board, they were approved by the council. And there's also the issue of the stormwater weir. I don't know how many of you did have a chance to go and look at it, but I did subsequent to the last meeting, and it is as was thought of the last time. It's a dam-like structure. I think in many respects it is a dam, except for the fact that it is much smaller in scope, and it has a little door-type arrangement that at the top that can be set at a certain level. And the purpose of it in this instance, it was a requirement of the planning board in order to control the water that was going down the brook in back of the homes in Delano Park, where there had been some concerns with flooding. And to my knowledge, it is working extremely effectively, and we didn't have the problems in this last storm with Shore Road flooding over like we had in some of the previous storm events. So I would encourage you to accept Dyer Pond Road, the drainage rights, the weir, Greystone Road, and Grant Ridge Road.
Thank you. I want to thank Mr. Taylor for going to the extra work of providing us with all the drawings that we requested last time. It was a lot of extra effort. Any comments? If not, I'd like a motion, please, on item number 98.
Madam Chairman.
Thank you, Jen.
First of all, I'll thank Mr. Taylor also for arranging that storm event over the weekend so we could test it out. I move that we accept Dyer Pond Road, the related drainage rights, and the stormwater weir associated with it.
Second.
Okay. All those in favor? 6-7-0. Item number 99, to consider acceptance of Greystone Road and take any necessary action.
So moved.
Second.
All in favor? 7-0. Item number 100, to consider acceptance of Granite Ridge Road and take any necessary action.
So moved.
Second.
All those in favor? Item number 101, to consider a report from the Ordinance Committee regarding the bicycle ordinance and take any necessary action. Council McLaughlin, would you like to...
I forgot this was on. The Ordinance Committee is very pleased to bring back to the full council a revised bicycle ordinance. I want to thank the manager for dealing with the language here. I believe we have satisfactorily addressed issues that were of concern to councilors and to members of the public that we've heard about either through public hearings or through private comments. The proposed bicycle ordinance would have the licensing of bicycles occur as a public service. It would not be a requirement. The ordinance sections relating to bicycle operation are the common sense safe operation requirements that we heard people wanting. Some of these say that you'll stay in the right side of the road except when you're making left-hand turns. You limit the ridership to the number your bike is designed for, things like that. You will not attach yourself to a moving vehicle, both for the safety of the bicycle rider and for everybody else using the public ways in the town. The language referring to bicycles themselves refers to bicycle equipment so that bicycles will be able to operate safely. This includes having a lighted lamp on the front of the bicycle, having reflectors or reflective tape that can be seen easily and clearly from the rear of the bicycle, and it be equipped with a functional brake. Seem to be the most important safety issues for the operation of a bicycle. In the penalty section, any violation of improperly operating a bicycle or operating a bicycle that wasn't properly safely outfitted according to the ordinance would be a misdemeanor and subject to a fine of up to $50.
Any comments from councilors? Councilor Amaral.
Yes, I'd like to thank the Ordinance Committee for doing an outstanding job, I think, of putting into very common sense language and not very regulatory, but all of the comments that at least I heard when we sent the ordinance back to you, I think it's very reasonable, very clear, and I would like to move that we set it for public hearing at the December 10th meeting.
Second motion.
Any further discussion?
I would like to thank the manager for the common sense language. He should take the credit for that.
All those in favor? I'm setting this for public hearing December 10th. 7-0.
I thought you put some language in there that was common sense.
Item number 102, to consider a proposed amendment to the personnel code clarifying the holiday provisions and take any necessary action. Mr. McGovern?
This particular item clarifies an issue in our personnel code. At this point, the only person involved is the full-time attendant at the transfer station. And when he works on holidays, there's always an issue of when does he take that holiday. And what this particular provision provides is that he would take it, on the next regular day that he would work, he would get that as a holiday. He has no problem with this particular provision. But the way it is written, it would affect other employees if others were in the same situation, with the exception of the public safety personnel, because if you had that rule in effect, what would happen is 2 days after the holiday or a day after the holiday, you wouldn't have anyone patrolling the streets. So it does not apply to public safety personnel.
Comments from councilors? Councilor Reid.
I just had one, and that was the use of the word the employee will take the holiday, and I had asked the town manager if maybe the employee may take it, or are we trying to avoid discretion and set policy specific?
You know, my whole attempt in this was to give the department head some direction and to have the council set forth, this is what we'd like. You know, if you would rather have it say May at the discretion of the department head, you know, I wouldn't have an objection to that. I think there needs to be a little clarity of the policy. The other issue, and the particular one that one of the issues here, is that when Harry Dean is, he's scheduled to work, I don't know, like 10 hours on a Monday. I did this off the top of my head. And the problem is the next scheduled day he's to work, he happens to be working 12 hours. And that's one of the problems that we have, you know, in grappling with this policy is, you know, what's really fair and what isn't. And to me, you know, this would give some direction that, you know, by the luck of the draw, he just happens to work a couple more hours the next day. And, you know, it's just the way we handle it. We give him that day off instead. But there is the issue of equity in terms of hours. But when you have someone working fluctuating time, you know, you've got to have a written policy to govern.
As far as the discretionary use of the department head, I mean, if the attendant himself preferred not to take that next day, and if there wasn't any problem, that could be just an administrative decision.
If you left it at the discretion of the department head, yes. Otherwise, I think my belief is the way it's drafted.
It's compulsory.
It's compulsory.
My comment would be everybody else is told which day they take off as the holiday. So I see no problem with the language as presented.
A motion?
I would move that we approve the proposed revision to Ordinance Section 3-2-1 of the town's personnel policy.
Second.
Any further discussion? All in favor? 7-0. Thank you. Item number 103, to consider the holiday status of Monday, December 24th, 1990, and take any necessary action. We have before us a letter from Town Clerk and Administrative Assistant Deborah Pizzo. Would you like to just inform the public as to your intent?
Thank you. Again, what we're talking about is holiday hours, specifically on Christmas Eve. This year, Christmas Eve does fall on Monday. My recommendation to the council is to allow all non-essential town offices to close for the entire day on Christmas Eve. The reasoning behind that is historically, the municipal offices have been very slow on Christmas Eve. And what we do is by seniority, employees are allowed to leave throughout the day, leaving only one or two employees to cover the office until 4:30. My feeling is, for the fairness and for the benefit of each employee, that we allow all our municipal employees to have the day off prior to Christmas to prepare for the holiday.
I would move the request.
Second.
Any discussion?
Just one question. When, as I read this, you said all employees.
Excluding personnel.
Right.
Okay. But I think this isn't the way it was put out across over the year. If I'm able to.
Non-essential or. That.
You did say non-essential.
Let me say that at the microphone. It doesn't apply to union personnel.
Okay. Thank you.
Any other comments?
Just cut off
their list. Councilor Amaro.
If we happen to have a major storm on the 24th, and we've said that this is a day off, does that mean that we have to pay extra benefits?
I would endeavor to,
work that day?
In the instance of those employees, I would endeavor to give them off December 31st instead. Hopefully that, you know, because Public Works, you know, if they're not working that particular day, some of the same things apply. However, if there was a bad storm on the 24th and the town office never opened, you know, they've got their holiday and they ought to feel happy, unless they're trying to get somewhere.
No, excuse me, if I may, Madam Chair.
Yes,
I think to add a little bit to what Councilor Amaro said, and I don't know whether you get the point, giving them the day off if they had to work, are we going to pay them time and a half?
Yeah.
I'm saying no, we'll give them off December 31st instead. And
unless there's another storm.
unless there's another storm, and we would try to make good somehow in order of fairness. You know, those guys really do an awful lot of work for the town, and I think do a tremendous job, not only during the winter, but otherwise. You know, I think we would want to follow the spirit of this as much as possible.
Well, I agree with what you're saying, and I agree with the proposal, and I just hope and I believe they will appreciate what is being done here.
Councilor Reed.
Yes, just a matter of record, I have spoken, and I could give you the names of over 200 people, none of which expect the town hall or library to be open. Yesterday, while I was at a meeting at the library, I spoke with Director Rollis and asked him if he felt that the library should be open, and he said no. And volume is extremely low, and the last two 24th dates have been on a weekend. But if you had gone back before then, there was virtually no customer traffic.
All those in favor of the motion? 7-0.
Thank you.
We're taking one item out of order. We have a new item 105 to consider a report from the Ordinance Committee relating to the proposed amendments to subdivision and zoning ordinance regarding application completeness plus other minor revisions and take a necessary action. Do you want Mr. McGovern perhaps to give us background on this particular section that was...
I think we can deal with it.
That is correct. Let him stretch his legs.
Senior member.
Caught me without my papers. I think the primary emphasis in this is to change the procedure for determining application completeness. There's been concern for some time that development proposals will come before the planning board in a way that is wasting the developer's time and the planning board as well, and that they're not really prepared to be before the planning board. What this particular provision does, and it does come from the planning board, is it gives the town planner working with the chairman of the planning board the right to tell a developer, hey, come on, you're not really ready, you're not going on the agenda. However, it doesn't, if you read it carefully, it doesn't go all the way and say they can specifically prohibit it from being on the planning board agenda, which I think is a, you know, there's a fine difference there. But the intent of this is to make the planning board's business a lot more orderly, and to ensure that the developers also have an orderly process as well. Hopefully then that the public knows too of when they ought to be directing their attention to the process of when there's key issues, and would hopefully resolve that. Beyond that, there's a clarification that all plans and materials have to be submitted 18 calendar days prior to the planning board's next scheduled meeting. That is the practice. However, the ordinance provision specifically did say working days. There's a clarification that when an application is when a site walk by the planning board is scheduled, that would not happen until after there's a dated receipt for the application. Again, that's fine-tuning the different procedures. They don't seem to make a whole lot of difference, but when you get into court 6 months down the road, people look and, when was it received, when that, and it just helps to have them orderly procedures. I was really expecting the Ordinance Committee to do this. Looking at it, that's essentially it.
Thank you.
I apologize for not being better prepared to discuss it.
Are there any questions? If not, I'd like a motion to perhaps set this for public hearing next month.
Madam Chairman, I move that we set for public hearing on December 10th at 7:30 the proposed amendments to the subdivision zoning ordinances regarding application completeness and the other minor revisions presented.
Second.
Any further discussion? All in favor? 7-0. We will take one other item out of order. Citizens' discussion of items not on the agenda. Our camera people do not wish to make any comments. Then we'll move on to item number 104, which is to consider entering into executive session to discuss a personnel matter and take any necessary action.
So moved.
Second.
Mr. McGovern.
Just one quick thing. I would like that to be several personnel matters involving council appointees, so that there's a couple other minor type issues that I would hope that could also be addressed.
Is this personnel matter?
Matters.
Matters.
Okay.
And cross the word up the word A.
So removed.
Yeah, that dash moved.
So reseconded.
Do you amend your?
I do, and I move.
Your motion.
You said that once before.
Seconder.
I take it.
All right.
I would just like to say, before we go into the executive session, that so the camera people can go
right.
home and we'll not
I
have
not
to wait for
them.
Us to come out, and I wish them all a fat turkey.
I want to thank you.
November 22nd.
Right. I want to thank you all for being with us this evening and our camera crew, and to wish you all a very happy Thanksgiving next Thursday. Thank you. Good night. Shall we move right on?